Live from Mitchell Hall at the University of Delaware, this is Delaware Debates.
Welcome. On behalf of Delaware First Media, WDDE 91.1 FM, and the University of Delaware Center for Political Communication, we welcome you to Delaware Debates 2012, made possible tonight by the financial support of AARP Delaware and the American Cancer Society Cancer Action Network. I'm Nancy Karibjanian. Joining me for this session is Jason Mycoff, University of Delaware Professor of Political Science and International Relations. And this is the candidates for the race for U.S. Senate, including the Democrat, Tom Carper, the incumbent. We're also joined by independent candidate Alex Pires and Republican Kevin Wade. Gentlemen, thank you so much. And Jason, thank you for joining me here to moderate this debate.
Thank you.
Now, this debate is divided into two sections. Following a one-minute opening statement from each of our candidates, Jason and I will pose questions to the candidates. Responses are limited to 1 minute and 30 seconds each, and then we will have a three-minute follow-up discussion. The second part of the debate, however, includes questions posed by students from the University of Delaware and Delaware State University. Responses in this portion are 1 minute. Each candidate also will have 1 minute for a closing statement. Our live audience here in Mitchell Hall understands that there will be no applause during tonight's debate. We did hold a coin toss to determine the order for this evening, and so we begin with our first opening statement, and for that, we turn to Tom Carper.
Thank you, and good evening. There are a lot of bomb throwers in Washington, D.C. We don't need any more of them. What we need are bridge builders, and that's what I do. I build bridges between Democrats and Republicans in Washington just to get things done like we do in Delaware. In Delaware, we realize we're all in this together. Democrats and Republicans, we work across the aisle. It's not my way or the highway. The values that I take with me every day to Washington, D.C. on the train are ones that I learned from my parents, from my church, and in the Navy. Number one, figure out the right thing to do, just do it. Number two, treat other people the way we want to be treated, golden rule. Number three, focus on excellence in everything that we do. If it isn't perfect, make it better. And number four, if you know you're right, just don't give up. Those have been the values that have guided me throughout my life. And if I'm fortunate enough to serve another term in the Senate, those will be the values that guide me for as long as I'm privileged to serve. Thank you.
And now an opening statement from Kevin Wade.
Thank you, Nancy. My name is Kevin Wade. It's a short name. It's easy to remember. I'm proud to be the Republican candidate for the United States Senate here, though I'm not here for the Republican Party, and certainly I'm not here for the leadership of the Democrat Party today. I am here because I know that Washington is broken, that damage has reached into our homes, and it threatens the future of our children and our grandchildren. I know that career politicians have done more to secure their own political prospects than they have to secure the future fortunes of America and Delaware families. I know that all of us need to go to Washington because Washington won't change until we change the people in Washington.
Mr. Pires, your opening statement.
Thank you. Why am I here? I'm here because I'm tired of the corruption in Delaware. Delaware is the most corrupt state in the Union, and Senator Carper is the most corrupt in our 200-year history. And I can prove that. Myself, I don't need this. I'm a successful businessman, a successful lawyer, I'm a successful banker, and I'm doing this because I want to bring an end to it. I come from a family, my parents didn't even go to high school, let alone college. I'm self-made, scholarship through law school, Justice Department. All along the way, I've been successful in everything I've done. I can easily turn the Senate around as an independent. There's going to be Angus King from Maine and Bernie Sanders from Vermont, and there's going to be Al Pires from Delaware, and we can bring this to an end. And the reign of Mr. Carper will come to an end, and his corruption will leave with him. Thank you.
All right, the stage is set. We'll now move into our question portion of this debate. And we'll begin with you, Mr. Carper. You know, of the issues that are facing Congress, the most critical is that ticking clock pushing the economy close to the so-called fiscal cliff, which some economists say will just plunge the economy right back into a deep recession. Regardless of the outcome of the 2012 election and any 11th-hour compromise that might come before any swearing-in ceremonies, what culpability, if any, does this Congress have in putting the U.S. economy in such a state of uncertainty?
First of all, let me just say with respect to Angus King and I served as governors together. Governor from Maine, I was governor for Delaware for six of those years. And he was recently interviewed in the Washington Post. They asked him, Which caucus will you join, the Republican or Democratic caucus? And he declined to say. And they said, well, who are some of the senators you'll first want to meet? And he said, I'd like to meet with Tom Carper. So we'll see what happens there. With respect to the fiscal cliff, we have a responsibility to make sure we don't go over it. And the best way to make sure that we don't go over it is to follow the deficit reduction plan, 10-year plan, put forth by the Bowles-Simpson Deficit Commission. And it's basically $4 to $5 trillion over 10 years. For every $1 on the revenue side, $3 on the spending side. And the revenues, we wouldn't raise taxes, but actually we'd actually lower the tax brackets, and we would broaden the base on income that is taxable. Everything's on the table. Entitlement programs, Democrats have to agree to make some compromises, reforms on entitlement programs. Republicans have to agree to make some reforms on taxes that generate some additional revenues. That is a great blueprint. I've seen a lot of blueprints that have been laid out. As far as I'm concerned, that's the best one that we've seen thus far. What we need are a strong leadership. What we need is to govern to the middle. And what we need is strong leadership from the president. President Obama, I hope, is going to be reelected. If he is, he needs to provide very strong leadership to get us there. And should it be Governor Romney, he needs to provide similar strong leadership. And the business community has to provide political air cover for the Republicans to agree to a deal like this. And our president has to provide, if you will, air cover for the Democrats to support entitlement reform.
Let's move into the moderated discussion of this. And I want to put the first point to you, Mr. Wade, in that you have touted a reliance on small business development as a means to restart the economy. But if you look at the polls from the Wall Street Journal, the small business community doesn't have faith that we are going to avoid a deep recession after falling off a fiscal cliff. So they are not making any plans for expansion or hiring for the final quarter of this year and going into the beginning of next year. So how can small business be a part of the solve?
They'll be a part of the solution once we bring small business common sense to Washington. The people who led us into this financial abyss will have no ability to lead us out of this financial abyss. I started a business on my kitchen table 30 years ago. I've had to balance a budget every month for 30 years. I've had to make the tough decisions. I run a specialty engineering business that requires that I solve the toughest problems put before me by my customers around this country and around the world. We need to bring common sense to Washington. That's what we lack.
So, Mr. Pires, if you take a look at what your two opponents have said here, and as you have said, you're going to be someone who's not going to caucus with any major party. So, in effect, though, regardless of any other independent that may be elected, as we try to get out of this fiscal mess, aren't you relegating yourself to a permanent sideline position?
No, it's the exact opposite. They don't get along. Why would you send back people who don't like each other and can't get along? Independents are taking over the country. New York City's the most complex city in the world. It's run by an independent. Vermont is run by an independent. Maine's going to be run by an independent. Rhode Island's run by an independent. The independents have the future because we work with everybody. He's only interested in doing whatever Senator Reid wants him to do. He's the water boy for the corporate industry. So he's never culpable. If you notice, your question was about culpability. Tom's never wrong about anything, ever. He lives this perfect life.
Well, let me let him answer it since we're in the discussion.
Well, he didn't answer it.
Well, the way that we got into this mess, if you'll go back, 2001, when we had a change of command from Clinton to Bush, we had balanced budgets for as far as the eye could see. We had the strongest economy on earth. We had the most productive workforce on earth. 8 years later, we had none of that. We're in a hole and sinking with trillion-dollar deficit. GM and Chrysler are about to go under. The bank's in trouble. That's where we were. That's where we were 4 years ago. For the last 4 years, we've been sort of building our way out of that hole. And we've reestablished it for the 5 million jobs that we lost between the last 6 months of 2008 and the first 6 months of 2009, those jobs have been sort of recreated. Can we do better than that? Sure we can. And the way we'll do that is to make sure we invest in those three things that you'll hear me say again and again tonight. Number one, invest in world-class workforce. Number two, invest in modern transportation infrastructure. Number three, invest in technologies that will provide for jobs through new goods, new services, and so forth that we'll create from those technologies, sell them all over the world. That's what we need to do.
All right, Jason Mycoff will now pose the next question to Mr. Pires.
Moving on to the national debt, a number of tax cuts are set to expire at the end of the year, including Bush-era tax cuts, relief for the middle class from the alternative minimum tax, Obama tax cuts for middle and low earners, and the payroll tax holiday. Without an extension of these tax cuts, the effects will be felt across all income levels. An extension of all of them would cost the government $500 billion a year in lost revenue. You've argued, Mr. Pires, that many Delawareans pay too much in taxes. Would you therefore seek to further cut taxes in addition to extending these tax breaks? Can we afford further tax cuts in the face of a large and increasing national debt?
2 points. This country, last time we had no debt, 1836, Andrew Jackson. We've had debt for 175 years. We had debt after World War II. We've always had debt. It's not going away. That's the way we live. For these people to talk about, even when we had balanced budgets under President Clinton for a couple of years, we still had huge national debt, and it's going to continue. Let's face it, between now and January, the Senate, the Congress, they're going to meet, they're going to extend the tax cuts. To act like they're not going to is just folly. The biggest problem is this. We spend far too much. We've got two wars we haven't paid for. We waste money abroad. Let's end the wars, and that's a first big start towards paying as we go.
Mr. Wade, during this campaign, you've argued for an overhaul of the tax code, while at the same time arguing for debt reduction. How would your tax plan address the large and increasing national debt?
Put people back to work. People who have work will have better jobs. People who have better jobs will get overtime. People who work on Saturday will be able to keep what they've earned if we overhaul this tax code. Many people in this audience know that 2 years ago, General Electric made $5 billion in profit in the United States and paid zero corporate income tax. We have loopholes everywhere, but not loopholes for we the people. We need to overhaul this tax code, which is 60,000 pages of nonsense, and remove it as an obstacle to our own prosperity.
We're into the moderated discussion. It's my understanding, though, that the GE tax situation was clarified, that that's not actually accurate, correct? I mean, it appeared that they didn't pay any taxes, but once it was clarified, it was because of estimated taxes, et cetera, that actually tax money had been paid by the corporation.
Could you tell us how much was paid?
No, I don't know that figure, but I do know it's not zero taxes, correct?
They made $14 billion worldwide. Now, what happens with our present tax code is if you have enough tax attorneys, you can pay a very small legal amount. If you can afford your own tax lobbyists, you can pay a very small amount. But all the folks in this room and across the state don't have tax attorneys. They don't have tax lobbyists. We're stuck paying the bills. Now, we need to overhaul this tax code if we're going to get serious about putting people back to work.
Just a reminder, we are in the discussion portion, so you're free to answer.
I agree with Kevin. We need to overhaul the tax code. And our friends, Erskine Bowles and Alan Simpson and the commission, what they've said, we should lower tax rates, top rate down from 35 to 28% for individuals and for businesses. They said we should broaden the amount of income that can be taxed. There's something called tax expenditures. You'll hear during the course of this debate and later on. Tax expenditures are things we like. Tax breaks, tax credits, tax loopholes. And if you add them all up over the next 10 years, it adds up to $15 trillion. What Paul Simpson says is let's cut those in half. Some tough decisions there, but cut those in half, expand the base of income that's taxable, and lower the rates. One rate up to, first signing for a couple, $70,000 and less, they'd pay about 12%. For income between $70,000 and $220,000, the rate would be 22%, and anything over that, the rate would be 28%.
That's so you call it a tough choice. Which tax deductions would you support eliminating?
I supported a bunch of them already. Mm-hmm. And we had a number of tax expenditures or tax breaks, tax credits, mm-hmm. and so forth, that had expired last December 31st. And here we were, like in August, and they'd still had not been extended, or we hadn't really made a decision. We got rid of a bunch of them. We literally pulled the plug on a bunch of them. I think they added about $25 billion over the next 10 years. One of the ones that I wouldn't kill would be the investment tax credit. We need to incentivize the investment in technologies that can be commercialized and turned into goods and services and products that we can sell around the world. And we need to work very, very hard to knock down trade barriers so that the technologies and the products that we do develop, we can sell into countries from not just Korea, Colombia, and Panama, but a lot of other countries as well.
I'd like to add something. Senator Carper, it's a little bit late in the campaign season to paint yourself as a tax cutter. 2 years ago, less than 2 years ago, in the midst of this great recession, when 20,000 homes were being foreclosed across Delaware, Senator Carper proposed, and I have a copy here, a 25-cent a gallon tax increase on gasoline. We have people who don't have jobs, who can't find jobs, who can't keep a roof over their heads, and you proposed a 25-cent a gallon tax increase? Mm-hmm. I believe this is the result of too many years in Washington and too many years away from Delaware. It's time to bring some small business common sense to bear on the problems that face our nation.
Do you have anything you'd like to add?
Well, have you ever heard of the Carper Bill or the Carper Act or anything in this country in the last 36 years that had Tom's name to it? Tom is not a leader. He's a follower. He's the water boy for the corporate banks. The four biggest banks in Delaware added up together are $7 trillion. They're bigger than nations, and this is They're a number one man. So you're never going to see any bill that ever helps anybody, any person. Are there any corporations in this room? It's all people. Answer is Tom Carper is essentially a bank man.
We will have the opportunity to continue that part of the conversation in a few moments, but we need to move on to our next question. And this question goes to you, Mr. Wade. The pullout of the surge troops in Afghanistan is now complete, and the reality of a post-2014 Afghanistan is in sight. Considering recent incidents, including the insider attacks on NATO forces within Afghanistan and the September attack on the U.S. consulate in Libya that killed four and is now believed to be connected to al-Qaeda, should this alter the course of action?
Of course it needs to alter the course of action. I'm a small businessman. I've been in difficult situations around this country and around the world. And the one lesson I've always taken away is that leadership counts. Leadership counts all the time, and leadership counts every time. We have basically an unwinnable situation under the current setup in Afghanistan. We either have to make a decision either to find a quick success or to bring our young men and women home. But we cannot linger, and we cannot have this indecision. This weakness is creating dangers for us, not only in Afghanistan, but throughout the Middle East. As you know, our embassies are aflame. We lost an ambassador just a few weeks ago and three other good Americans, while all we heard from the White House was confusion and silence from Senator Carper.
Senator Carper, we will now move into the discussion portion of this topic.
With respect to Libya, it's a tragedy, and it's one of those tragedies that occurs abroad, loss of American lives, where actually the Republican Party's candidate for president, I think, sought to find political advantage in that, which I think was abhorrent. Here's what's happened since then. A commission, Blue Ribbon Commission, led by Thomas Pickering, including Admiral Mullen, former chief of, head of the Joint Chiefs of Staff, has been created. They have this job. Their job is to find out what went wrong. Their job is to make sure that we find out, do we have a situation around the world and other places where that can go wrong again? What can we learn from this tragic episode, and what can we do to make sure that it doesn't happen again? Not to find political favor, not to look for political advantage, but to look for the truth and make sure that we act on the truth. And with respect to Afghanistan, if you go back, the history of Afghanistan is called the graveyard of empires. Graveyard for the British, they pulled out, who came in and filled the vacuum? Well, the Soviets. The Soviets pulled out, who filled the vacuum? Well, the Taliban. And we drove out the Taliban, who came in? Al-Qaeda. I mean, there's a lesson that we need to learn.
But you have said end the wars because of spending.
No, not because of spending. I agree with Tom about Libya. It's a horrible tragedy. I don't make fun of our diplomatic corps. I think we have the best in the world. They tried really hard. I don't like the Republicans or the Democrats making fun of them at all. I'm not that type of person. With respect to Afghanistan, we've been there 11 years. We got in there because we thought the Taliban, were controllable. It's a third world country at best. It's so gigantic, we can't ever get control of it. I also agree with Tom with respect to the British couldn't do it, the Soviets couldn't do it, we couldn't do it. I want to bring our troops home. This is a backward nation. We're wasting billions of dollars. Let's come home and take care of our own people. These people out here, these students, their parents, their families, Bring the war to an end now. Yes.
It was said that you are, I believe you said, making fun of our diplomatic corps. I need clarification.
Well, they were fighting between the Republicans and the Democrats about the statement Mr. Romney said, and then their response. I know Kevin didn't mean it. I'm just saying, stop arguing over what happened. It was a tragedy.
Let's
move it on.
I'm not here to explain the mistakes of the Republican Party. I have no interest in that. I'm a grandfather, I have grandchildren. I worry deeply, as many people in this audience do, about the future of our country. This Democrats did it, Republican did it, the back and forth. It has to end. We have real problems. We have problems militarily, we have problems with our national security, we have problems with our job situation. We don't have an energy policy that makes sense. And pointing fingers and blaming one another in Washington is the Washington way. I've never gone to a job site to fix a problem where I could spend 5 minutes talking about who created it, we're appointing a commission. Leadership counts, it counts every time, and it counts all the time. And we've got to take action now, and we need people who can bring small business common sense to the great problems that face our nation.
Let's move from the Middle East and talk about China. How do you think we should be dealing with China moving forward as a nation?
We don't want to end up in an adversarial, long-term adversarial relationship with the Chinese. At the end of the day, we're better served and they're better served is if we can be competitors, but if you will, friendly competitors. That includes making sure that they do not keep our goods out. They don't have tariff and non-tariff barriers to keep our goods out, to make sure that they're not manipulating their currency in an effort to gain advantage. And it means also making sure that the kind of cyber attacks that are going on every day, not by kids trying to create mischief, but by, if you will, by criminal organizations, by sovereign nations to try to steal our intellectual property rights, that we have put in place a defense to defend our intellectual property rights and our military secrets and our personal data.
Mr. Wade?
We already have an adversarial relationship with China. Washington and its career politicians have in fact created tens of millions of jobs in the past 20 years, but they've been created in Shanghai and Beijing and Mumbai and New Delhi and not in Smyrna or Dover or Wilmington. They have been manipulating their currency. They actually export their toxic products mixed in with drywall that they sell here. We need to actually send, you know who we need to renegotiate these agreements? We need to get the business agent for the roofers union to go over there and do some real negotiation.
Let's let Mr. Pires jump in here.
I have a different view. I've been to Shanghai and I've been to Beijing. I have a totally different view of China. Let me give you a fact that you all understand. Anybody here got an iPod? Cost $299. Cost $144 to make. You know how much China contributes? $4. Transistor, the core is made in Japan. There's a lot of myth about China. They just lost 16 million jobs in the last 7 years because of industrialization. Stop worrying about China and stop worrying about ourselves. It's a myth.
Let's move on to our next topic, and Jason will pose this question to Mr. Carper.
The next topic is on health care. Many Delawareans are concerned that Social Security and Medicare will not be there for them in their current form when they retire because of spiraling costs. Mr. Carper, Mr. Pires has charged that you support privatizing Social Security. Do you support privatization of this program? Do you support other changes to Social Security that would affect the benefits?
Yeah, that's hogwash, pure and simple. When George Bush proposed doing this, a group of us wrote to him in 2004, again in 2005, said, bad idea, don't try to do it. 2006, I voted against it. 2007, I voted against it again. We prevailed in both of those votes. It's just hogwash. The Bowles-Simpson proposal actually addresses Social Security. And what they say in turn for the changes that I've already talked about in terms of generating revenues, working on the spending side, what they say with respect to Social Security is this. What we should consider doing, much as we did in 1983, is vote to gradually raise the full retirement age on Social Security from 67 to 68 by 2050, and from 68 to 69 by 2075. We should make sure that people that are working for state and local governments not paying into Social Security should pay into Social Security. And the amount of income that's currently on which we currently pay the FICA tax, it's about $110,000. Everything above that, there's no FICA tax paid. What they're suggesting is that we raise somewhat that limit. That's pretty much it. And if we do a handful of fairly simple, easy things, we can make Social Security secure for another 75 years. That's the kind of thing that we ought to do. It doesn't hurt the people on Social Security to now. It gives people plenty of warning that changes are coming. But we make sure that it's going to be there for his grandchildren and, frankly, for mine someday.
Can I respond to that?
We're in the moderated discussion now that he's finished his response.
This is my statement. None of that's true, Tom. I'm going to quote you because you seem to forget. This is Tom Carper in 2005. I don't rule at some point having private accounts for Social Security. That's you, Tom. That's a quote. 2004, let me finish. This is Tom Carper talking with Mr. Bush about working together to have private accounts. Quote, I'll meet him halfway, November 23rd, 2004. There's another article in the Orlando Sentinel talking about Thomas Carper saying he's trying to work together to have a system in which we can have private accounts. That's in November 2004. There's three examples. This is what Mr. Carper does. Whoever talks to him last, or whoever gives him a check, that's his most recent statement. The banks want privatization, so he wants it. But now that he's in front of you, oh no, it's not going to happen. I mean, Tom, you're not telling the truth. You are a proponent for privatization for the big banks.
I need to let Mr. Carper respond since this is a direct...
Just remember, this is a three-way discussion.
I understand that, but this was a direct comment toward the record of Mr. Carper, so he gets an opportunity to address it.
If Alex will actually dig into this a little bit, what he'll find out is that I said, I want to keep the guaranteed benefit for Social Security. If people would like to have an add-on benefit, a private account, in addition to what is offered by Social Security, they could have that. I'm not opposed to doing that. But the idea is not to do that in a way that undermines traditional Social Security. That's what I said. And frankly, a lot of other people feel that way as well.
Now, I want to add something. Senator Carper, here in October of an election season, talks about Simpson-Bowles, but you haven't brought it up to a vote in the Senate in a year and a half or 2 years. In fact, they haven't even passed a budget, which is a constitutional requirement, in 3 years. It's a day late and a dollar short. This is grandstanding and posturing for re-election. This is not leadership. This is not solving America's problems. You mentioned in your statement that we had some easy steps to take. Well, Senator, why didn't we take those easy steps last year for Social Security, or 2 years ago, or 8 years ago, or 10 years ago?
Well, we took them in 1983 when I was a brand new.
You've been a senator for 12 years,
and you know
senator.
What? We preserved Social Security.
You've been
for
a senator
40
for 12 years.
Years.
Let's let him
another
answer.
40 years. We, in 1983, we voted to do a number of things, benefit reductions and increases in revenues. We preserved Social Security for another 40 years. And it's still, you know, they can still pay the bills, but starting in 2033, we're going to have to begin reducing the amount of Social Security payments. Why wait till 2033 to fix it? We can do three or four simple things now, put it on sound footing
Nancy,
for 75 years.
How would you seek to strengthen?
It's the fact that 40 cents of every dollar that Washington spends this year is borrowed money, and that includes Social Security. 40, not 14, not 4. 40 cents of every dollar in federal spending is borrowed money. It can't continue. We need to have real solutions to the real problems. This political gamesmanship of kicking the can down the road and referring to blue ribbon commissions doesn't get the job done. People are suffering in this state. We need new leadership. We need common sense.
So what is your solution?
Very quickly, because we do need to move on to the next question. Well, I guess we'll just table that for the moment and move on. This next question goes to Mr. Pires. The Obama administration actually sidestepped Congress on the immigration reform issue by calling for the halt of the deportation of children of undocumented immigrants, one of the provisions of the so-called failed DREAM Act. Mm-hmm. This issue evokes considerable debate in Sussex County, where you reside, especially for the agriculture industry and for the poultry industry, which relies upon the immigrant labor force. Would you push for the provisions of the DREAM Act and a path to citizenship for the undocumented residents of Sussex County?
My answer is twofold. Yes, I would. I don't like the idea of splitting up families, and I'll give you a personal example. I have 8 companies in Sussex County. I have about 400 full and part-time employees. Many of them are Hispanic. We make sure they all have the proper paperwork, Social Security, and we provide those that we can with insurance, the full-time people we can afford, but we can't even afford insurance from all of them. It's another issue. But I don't like the idea, and I supported the president, I don't like splitting up families. If we believe in anything in this country, we believe in family. And the idea that we would take families and split them up is not anything you'll ever get support of me on. I feel strongest about that. I think the president meant well. I supported him when he came out. And it's not because there are things going on in Sussex County that are under the table in any way. We follow the law. I'm a practicing lawyer. I have a license. I have lawyers who help me do it. We try to follow the law. We do. And these people who work for us are good people and family people. And the idea that we would split them up, don't forget, some of their children have been born here. They're citizens. And the idea that we would split these families up, you're not going to get any support from me at all. Not at all.
However, though, the Gallup poll says it's just a non-starter issue this election season. So do you think it's just become a back burner problem?
I think we've scared people. I think we've scared people, I do. I'm just saying you're not going to get support for me to split up families. That's not happening.
Let's open up the conversation then on the issue of immigration.
If you go back a few years, George W. Bush was our president. John McCain was thinking of running for president. And both of them teamed up with a guy, I think, Ted Kennedy. And they came up with a comprehensive immigration reform proposal. And came to the floor, we debated it, kicked it around some, and finally said, no, we're not ready to, this is not ready for prime time. And instead what we did is we focused on securing our borders. Our borders were porous, and we made the decision, before we do comprehensive immigration reform, why don't we secure our borders? And that's what we've done. And I think for the most part, we've done a pretty good job at it. When this election's over, we're going to have an opportunity with a new president and a new Congress to revisit this issue. This president has used his own executive powers to say kids under the age of 16, they were brought here, you know, by their parents at an early age. If they've stayed out of trouble, they're doing well in school, they're not guilty of, you know, crimes, and they're trying to get an education or serve in the military, they can stay. They can stay for, they can't become like citizens, but they can stay for a period of time.
I think I'm the only one sitting at this table who's actually worked in Mexico. I worked in northern Mexico for quite a while. I have many Mexican friends, many of whom no es legal, many of whom cross the border illegally, regularly. Border security, in fact, in northern Mexico is considered a joke by Mexicans. We don't have secure borders. Politicians saying we do doesn't make a difference. We are a nation, in fact, of immigrants. Immigration is red corpuscles in our bloodstream. We need immigration. It feeds the American spirit. But there are many right ways to do it, and there's a handful of wrong ways to do it. It's not hard to come here legally. It's not hard to become a citizen. Let's just follow the path that others have taken that have built this nation.
We began with you. We'll let you take us out on it.
I think it's a false issue, and I agree with your earlier comment. Let's be realistic. The border is almost 2,000 miles. It's four states. It's six Mexican states, equivalents, if you will. It's enormous. I've been through all of Mexico and Texas. Texas is the size of Europe. And the idea that you're going to have a perfect wall and we're going to blame the Democrats or Republicans for it is a folly. I think we need new immigration reform, like Tom talks about, and the sooner the better. But in the meantime, let's protect our families, that first and foremost, and particularly those children who were born here who are just as much citizens as everybody in this room. They are citizens.
We will now move on to our next topic. It's your question to be posed to Mr. Wade.
We've talked a lot about policy. I want to move to another role a U.S. senator plays. The Senate plays an important role in providing advice and consent to the president in regards to judicial appointees. Mr. Wade, which current Supreme Court justice comes closest to your ideal justice, and why?
Actually, it's not an important role. It's a constitutional requirement that the Senate provide advice and consent to appointments by the President of the United States. It's one of the most important roles of a U.S. senator. I like Justice Alito because he reads the Constitution and he believes it. He interprets as it's written, and I think that provides a stability in the path of judicial temperament and precedence in this country. We don't want to have an activist Supreme Court that would upend our entire legal system, which then connects to our business system, which then connects to our personal lives.
And I'd like to follow up with each of you,
please,
as well.
I'm a practicing attorney, have been for 35 years. I met a number of them. I don't like or dislike any of them. I respect them. I study them. I'm a student of them. I have a very serious law practice, so I don't make comments about judges. Judges may make comments about me, and you may have been online and see some of them, that in the end, I don't take positions on them at all.
Could you share with us your feelings on judicial philosophy?
Yes. Look, our Supreme Court justices are everyday people, and when you meet them as you get older, you find they're just like you and me. They make mistakes. What mistakes? Dred Scott, they said blacks were not, in effect, equal to whites, that they were property. They made a mistake. They made a mistake during World War II with our Japanese internment. They make mistakes all the time. I think they made a couple of mistakes just recently. You know which ones they are. They're just humans, and they come and they go. People talk about the Supreme Court as if they have some special talents. They don't. I've met a number of them. They're average intelligence, most of them. I respect them. I work under them. I practice federal law, that's all I do. So all of my cases, in one way or another, are only a step and a half from them. So I like our Supreme Court. I have tremendous respect for them, but I don't take pot shots at them.
Mr. Carper. Well, when I was governor, and running for governor, we had a lot of joint appearances in 1992 with my Republican opponent. Nobody ever asked in all those joint appearances, what factors would you consider as governor in nominating people to serve on the bench? It turns out it's a big deal in Delaware. Because we have the Court of Chancery, a lot of corporate laws down here, Superior Court, and so the Supreme Court. And but as it turns out, as a lot of what a governor does, it's a major job. And what I did is I developed, if you will, almost a sort of a checklist of things that I look for. And I won't go through the whole thing, but I wanted to make sure the people that I nominated were knew the law. I wanted to make sure that they had the kind of judicial temperament that they would treat everybody before them fairly and with respect. I wanted to make sure that they had a strong work ethic. And then we just nominate somebody for one of these lifelong jobs or 12-year jobs in Delaware, and then let them retire on the job. I wanted to nominate people who had a reputation for being able to make had good judgment, were able to make a decision, and hopefully a good one. When people are nominated by the president for the Supreme Court, they actually come and meet with guys like me. And one of the people who came and met with me is John Roberts. John Roberts. And someday I'd love to be able to tell you the John Roberts story as it coincides with Dewey Beach, where he met his wife, in a beach house all those years ago. Fell in love, got married.
Let me shift our focus for just a moment to political temperament as we talk about this. And I have to put this to you, Mr. Pires, because you posted your health information on your campaign website, and you have asked the incumbent to reveal his health status. You have inferred that he's not in good health. My question is very simple. I don't understand. Why go there? Why offer unsubstantiated information such as that?
It's not unsubstantiated. Can I address it?
Yes.
Yeah. If Tom Carper is emotionally and mentally healthy, he would end it by putting his health records out. And he won't, because I've been with him, Tom, and this is a difficult issue. We were at the JCC, the Jewish Community Center debate, and right in the middle of it, Tom completely lost his way, had to ask what question it was. You have difficulty focusing, Tom. It's a fact. I don't know what diseases or problems you have, but it's not fair. This is a six-year term. I think what's happening is he intends to step down in the spring if he gets reelected and the governor gets to pick. I think it's wrong. I think it's undemocratic.
So we have just a bit of time. I'd like you to take this opportunity.
I think you should.
And clarify.
What medicines do you take, Tom?
Let's clarify him.
You can check my website. You can check my campaign website. There is a letter there from the Navy doc who for a number of years is giving my physical every year that says, this is the kind of shape this guy's in. These are the medicines that he takes. And he is doing just fine. And so I would invite you to take a look at that. And
it's not a physical issue, Tom. It's an emotional issue.
But I think that we've given both of you a chance to say your piece on this issue that has been
baloney. Why don't we focus on the health of our fiscal? Why don't we focus on the idea that we have all these people that are overweight and obese and costing us a fortune? Why don't we focus on
our
economy?
Are you going to release your medical records? No, I've provided,
as you have put on your website, a letter from my physician that says, this is the guy's condition, these are his numbers.
My records are there.
But that was your choice to put it on. I think that we've given each of you the opportunity to address it. We're going to move on to the student questions at this point.
Dr. Pires would do well to focus on the health of our economy, our finances, and the health of all the people who don't have any health care coverage.
This is just like Senator Roth 12 years ago.
Gentlemen, I need to ask you
to allow me to move on to the student questions. I gave the topic its moment, and we now need to move on. We're going to go to our first question, which comes from a University of Delaware senior biomedical engineering major.
With the recent increase in national attention regarding gay marriage, what's your stance on marriage equality?
Mr. Carper, you're first.
Sure. For as long as I can remember, we have said to the states in this country have the ability to decide who can marry and who can't, at what ages, first cousins, second cousins, and so forth. States set the rules for property settlements, child custody, all those kinds of issues. And states have also said that the people of same sex cannot marry in those states. And what the Defense of Marriage Act is federal. Defense of Marriage Act does, according to the courts, we've had four or five federal courts have now said the Federal Defense of Marriage Act is unconstitutional, and we cannot at the state at the federal level do something that would treat people who are involved in same-sex relationships that would disadvantage them, be unfair, inequitable to them. And the question is, would I vote to repeal the Defense of Marriage Act? I would. And when you've got four or five federal courts saying it's unconstitutional, I think we need to fix it.
That wasn't the question.
I rest my case. Do you understand anything he said? It was a complete gogglygook. I support gay marriage. Gay people are equal. Marry whoever you want. Love who you want. Do you get that? It's real simple. I support gay marriage. Tom Carper's answer is just nothing but double talk. That's what you get when you get this senator. I support gay marriage.
I believe everyone in this country is, in fact, treated equally. I know that no one has the right to stand on anyone's back porch and stare through the screen door and make some approval gesture or disapproval of how they live their life in their own home. My focus is not gay marriage. My focus is on the children of this country and what their future is. It's a fringe issue today. Today, we're focusing as a people. Ask what's on their mind. What do they worry about? They worry about jobs, their homes, this country, and the future of their children and grandchildren. Their concerns are my concern. I'm not going off on side issues. I will state for the record, I know that marriage is between a man and a woman, and it's the fundamental building block of any community and any nation.
Let's move on to our next student question, and it's the uncertainty in the job market that prompts this question from sophomore political science major Andrew Donnelly.
With the unemployment rate of recent college graduates hovering around 40%, what, if anything, can the federal government do to help students get a return on their investment?
Mr. Pires, your response.
Two things. One, I don't think the federal government creates jobs, Andrew, but I think small businesses does. 70% of all the jobs in the country are small business. But what can the government do? I think we should do something about all this debt that the students are carrying. We subsidize everything else. We subsidize all of Tom Carper's banks. Why can't we subsidize and help out students? I think we should have a program that helps students get out of this massive debt. Then you won't have so much pressure about worrying about a job if you didn't have all this debt on your back. It's over $1 trillion of student debt.
Okay, now we have a chance to talk about the economy. Four things we need to do. This is a four-lane superhighway to prosperity. Okay, this is how to make America shiny penny new. Overhaul the tax code. Simple but difficult to do, but it needs to be done. Rationalize our regulatory system. In the past 3 years, we've added 11,000 pages in federal regulations. That's too much. We need to reduce the size of the federal government. The deadweight burden of this obese government is crushing this country. It needs to be smaller. We need more miles per gallon for every dollar of revenue we put in. And finally, we have to be serious about having an energy policy. There is a treasure of resources beneath our feet. Oil and gas. We need to lift it up to keep our money at home, bring our troops home, rebuild this economy. And frankly, Nancy and Jason, if we claimed a $15 a barrel royalty on the 1 trillion barrels of oil that's beneath our feet over the next 50 years, we could pay off the national debt. That's how we make jobs for these
students.
Just
a reminder, we have a minute for these responses to student questions, and it's time for your minute, Mr.
I think the best jobs bill is to enact the Bowles-Simpson deficit reduction plan. That is a simple, that's the best thing we could do. It provides certainty. Can we govern? Can we be fiscally responsible? Can we provide certainty for the tax code? And the answer is yes, yes, yes. Guys like me, I mean, if Kevin or Alex are elected, we don't create jobs in these jobs. Governors, mayors, presidents, senators don't create jobs. What we do is help create the nurturing environment for jobs. Access to credit, common sense regulation, safety, public safety, trained workforce, infrastructure, broadly defined, roads, highways, bridges, ports, railroads, all the above, dunes, beaches replenished, dunes along the beach line, clean environment, clean water, so that people actually want to come to places like Dewey Beach and recreate.
You should come down.
And I do. And clean up the air, provide transportation so people can get there. You know, with all that we've done in terms of the infrastructure, I could make money going
Tom
to business
likes
down
me.
There.
We need to
move on to our next student question. Again, though, it's about money. Right. The financial burden of a postgraduate degree tuition is the focus of our next question, and it comes from Malik Foster, senior political science major at Delaware State University.
With the recent cutting back of assistantships and graduate student scholarships, what are your plans as senator to help support low to middle income Americans further their education beyond an undergraduate level?
Mr. Wade?
Well, first of all, let me congratulate you for your aspirations to continue your education. You will be a leader of this country one day. We, unfortunately, at this moment, as a people, are eating the bitter fruit, the bad harvest of so many years of failures in Washington. The easy choices were overlooked years ago. We're coming up on a crisis with Medicare, with Social Security, with funding for higher education. We can't keep making cotton candy promises. We need to have practical, common sense solutions. We have an interest bill on this federal debt that will soon overtake the cost of Medicare. We'll have to choose whether or not to pay interest to our Chinese debt holders or honor our commitments to our seniors. It's gone on too far. Washington won't change until we change the people in Washington.
Mr. Carper, we'll come to you after Mr. Carper's one moment.
I think the question is what can we do for people beyond undergraduate to help them get an advanced degree? Is that what he's asking? And I would just say, my parents never went to college. They went to high school, they're proud of that. They expected my sister and me to go to college. They expected us to figure out how to pay for it. I ended up winning this Navy ROTC scholarship. I worked two jobs at Ohio State. I washed pots and pans. I worked in a bookstore. in order to be able to make ends meet. I bought a car before I graduated from college, and I went to Southeast Asia, and I saved every other paycheck and sent money back to my sister so she could go to school as well. So part of this responsibility is not just what can government do for me, but what can we do for ourselves? And so there's something that we can do for ourselves. We have people that are coming back from Afghanistan, having served in Afghanistan or Iraq, and they get free tuition to go to University of Delaware, Del State, Del Tech, Widener, free tuition, free books, all that stuff paid for, $1,500 a month housing allowance. And we do that because they've served our country. So I would just suggest for people that are struggling, looking for help, don't be afraid to do some work yourself. Don't be afraid to serve in the military and take advantage of the GI Bill.
Mr. Pires.
Yeah, there are practical problems. And Malik, I'll try to answer your question this way. I taught with my wife in law school for a number of years at Georgetown University. It's very, very expensive. The students were completely in debt over it. And we pushed and pushed, and everybody's pushed for more scholarship help, but it is a serious problem. Medical school is even worse. And our sciences, in the field of sciences, where we need so much help in engineering, it's a difficult, difficult problem. I think the federal government is strapped to support some, not the other. And I don't think it's a problem with a simple solution. And I don't want to give Malik, you know, an answer that's disingenuous. I think in the end, the undergraduate student debt is going to drive some assistance in the graduate level. I think the government has to do something about it. We can't have between $1 trillion and $1.3 trillion of student debt and not do something about it. It is a serious, serious problem, and I don't have the answer.
Our next student question comes from Stephanie Schmidt, junior public policy major at the University of Delaware. She poses our next question.
The achievement gap has existed for a really long time in the American education system. How do you plan on ensuring teacher accountability?
I couldn't hear the first part, I'm sorry.
The issue of the achievement gap. And I do believe that, Mr. Pires, you're first up on this question.
I gotta be honest with that, I don't understand the question. And I taught in high school, I taught in college, and I taught in law school, so help me. What does she mean by the achievement
gap? None of your students had that gap.
Is she talking about the difference between?
Those who are able to achieve and those who are not, based probably upon the building blocks of their earlier education.
Right. I have to be honest with you. I'm not interested in the federal government being involved like they are in many of the programs. I think it's a local and regional problem, if that's what she's talking about. But about how to bring people up, and particularly in our minorities and our people, I don't like where we're headed. We're going to end up with private schools, public schools, charter schools, voucher schools, and then we're going to have homeschooling with vouchers. So I don't like the direction it's heading, and we're going to have a five-tier system in which the poor are going to be left behind. So if you're asking me if I'm going to support that, if that's what she's asking, I'm not in favor of it at all. I'm in favor of universal education for everybody on an equal basis. I don't like where it's heading.
Mr. Carper, my apologies. You were actually supposed to answer first to
I'm
that.
I'm sorry.
But that's okay. Maybe he could have helped us with the achievement gap question.
I don't quite understand
but
it.
Your response to that.
For 8 years as governor, I focused on three things: environment, economy, education, raising student achievement. The key to raising student achievement is not to wait till kids are in high school or in middle school or even in elementary school. You're a mom yourself, you know, the key is like getting involved early on so that when they walk into kindergarten at the age of five, they're ready to be successful because they already know their numbers, they know their alphabet, they've had good early pre-kindergarten training. The role of the federal government here is to level the playing field for kids who come from those disadvantaged backgrounds. It's programs like Head Start. The federal government only funds half of the kids eligible for Head Start. We need to do 100%. In the state of Delaware, when I was governor, we took state money and fully funded Head Start so that every kid who is in poverty at the age of four could be in a Head Start program. We need to make sure that, and I might say I'm really proud of what we did, but if you go back the last 19 years, Harvard and Stanford just released a study. They said the last 19 years, in terms of the best improvement in student achievement in America, Delaware is in the top three states. And it started with the foundation that we laid starting in the 8 years that I was governor. I'm proud of that.
Did you see what child left behind?
This achievement gap goes away by doing simple things, caring things. Read a story to your two-year-old. Talk to your three-year-old about what the colors are and shapes and apples and oranges and be involved with their education so that when they get to pre-K and kindergarten, they can count to 10, that they know their colors, that maybe they can spell their name. It begins at home. One example of failures in Washington is about 30 years ago, the Federal Department of Education was created with much fanfare as a means to reduce the educational gap between our kids and kids overseas that are foreign competitors. Well, that gap still exists after, 40 years. This is what's wrong in Washington. Money is spent and there is no accountability. We don't have an education gap. We have a performance gap by our professional administrators in our education system.
We can't get beyond the issue that politics tends to bring about argument. So what one statement, and I'll put this to you first, Mr. Carper, has one of your opponents made about you that has actually bothered you the most? And why has it bothered you, and how would you respond to it?
He says that Delaware is the most corrupt state, and that I'm the most corrupt U.S. senator that we have in the country. He says Delaware is a second-class state. I'm so proud of this state. I can't tell you, but I will. This is a state that went from the worst credit rating in the country when I was elected state treasurer, and when I was governor, best credit rating. This is a state that has the highest regard for our judiciary of any state in the nation. We recognize year after year after year. This is a state that has the best, some of the best beaches, two out of the best four beaches in America. This is a state that has world-class beaches. This is a state where so many companies want to incorporate from all over the world. We're the choice of incorporations. This is a state that has built an excellent environment for job creation. And this is a state, as I said earlier, for the last 19 years, three states lead the pack in terms of academic improvement. I help on every one of those, and I am proud of that.
What comment has bothered you the most and why?
I don't sweat the small stuff, Nancy. I grew up in a row house in Pennsylvania. We were poor. I mean, poor. I went to work in a steel mill 3 days after high school, and I dodged the hot steel and I earned a man's paycheck. And I began to go to college when I wasn't in that mill. I came here a couple years later, and every good thing in my life has happened in Delaware. I don't sweat the small stuff, but I love my grandchildren, and I refuse to see this country broken, broke, and bankrupt at the hands of professional politicians in Washington. The best people in this country are not in Washington. They live on your street. They sit across the lunch table from you. They're everyday Americans, and it's time for all of us, we the people, to go to Washington to do the hard work that should have been done years ago. But it needs to be done now, not for Republicans, not for Democrats, but for our children and our grandchildren. Nothing bothers me from these two people.
I don't know if you all know what I do for a living. I represent the people that no one wants to represent. Johnny Cochran wouldn't take the black farmer's case. I wrote the complaint myself. I traveled the country for years with J.L. Chestnut, who represented Martin Luther King, and I won the black farmer's case. My way, the rough way, the tough way, over $1 billion. Won the woman's case, the Native American case, the tobacco farmer's case. And through all that, you get beat up and made fun of and insulted, and they came to my house and break my windows and all the things that happened. What I learned from it is, in the end, it doesn't really matter. What really matters is that you try very hard to inspire others to do for those people who can't do for themselves. And I have tough skin. There's probably nothing that anyone in this room could say to me that hasn't been said before.
Gentlemen, thank you so much. Jason and I appreciate you addressing the issues, the many issues that we've had the opportunity to put on the table this evening, in addition to hearing from the students at the University of Delaware and Delaware State University, who brought also equally interesting issues to our table. As you know, now it's time for our closing statements. You each have 1 minute for a closing statement. Mr. Wade, you are first up.
Well, thank you, Nancy. Thank you, Jason, for hosting us. I want to thank the AARP and the American Cancer Society for their sponsorship, and I want to thank everyone for coming out this evening. I stand here and speak of an America shiny, penny new, a nation that can finally find real energy independence, a nation that in the next decade can create tens of millions of jobs, a nation that can pay its own bills, a nation that can pay down this mortal curse of this national debt, a nation that can bring our troops safe home. But this only happens if we choose a new course. We can't stay in this abyss. We can't stay gridlocked in a Congress that doesn't do the work it was paid to do. It's time to bring real deal, all-American common sense, an engineer's problem-solving ability to the great problems before us. I tell you now, it's okay to like Tom Carper. It's okay to like Tom Carper, but on November 6th, you must love your children and your grandchildren more. God bless all of you, and God save the United States of America.
Mr. Pires.
Thank you. Thank you all for coming. I hope it wasn't too boring for you. I thought it was somewhat interesting, but it's tough. This type of discussion is difficult. I'm a very frank person. That's what happens when you're self-made. That's what helps when you're, in effect, someone who brings yourself along, isolated. My parents, like as I said, didn't even go to high school. I'm a tough person. I didn't need this. I didn't want this. I tried to get somebody to run against Tom Carper because I think Tom Carper was probably a good legislator 15, 20 years ago. And he's become what they all become when they're there too long. They become horribly corrupt. He's become rich because he's a stock trader. He's a day trader. He's everything that I don't like about government. And I think he should quietly step aside, but he doesn't want to. So I forced myself to run. I don't really want this job, but I'll do it. I'll do it for 6 years and pass along to one of you, because I think the country needs new faces. I think it needs independent faces. I'm someone who inspires other people. I'd like to inspire you to run. Thank you.
All right, Mr. Carper, you have 1 minute for your closing
statement. I don't know how I could say this stuff with a straight face. I don't know. Unbelievable. Well, let me just say to everyone who's joining us, thanks for joining us. Thanks for letting me serve you for 23 years as a naval flight officer. Serve as our state's treasurer, congressman, governor, and senator. The challenges that we face are daunting. If I'm reelected, I'll focus on three things. One, job creation. Number two, deficit reduction. Number three, changing the culture in Washington away from culture of spendthrift to a culture of thrift. We need to do three things to really pump up an economic recovery. One, invest in our workforce. Number two, invest in modern transportation systems. Number three, invest in technologies that can be commercialized, create goods, products, and service that we can sell all over the world. Deficit reduction, the key on deficit reduction is Bowles-Simpson Deficit Commission recommendations. It's a good roadmap, we should follow it. And finally, with respect to this culture of spendthrift which pervades federal government, what I've sought to do is to say, let's look in every nook and cranny of the federal government and ask of every federal program, how can we get a better result for less money, and do that.
All right, gentlemen, thank you so much. It's been a very interesting conversation as we talk about the issues that the voters will be thinking about when they go to the polls on Election Day. Jason Mycoff, thank you so much for joining us from the University of Delaware and helping with putting these issues out here. And we also want to thank our audience here in Mitchell Hall and those who have tuned in to hear about the issues in Delaware Debates 2012. I'm Nancy Karibjanian. On behalf of Delaware First Media, WDDE 91 FM, and the University of Delaware Center for Political Communications, we thank you for joining us. Good night.
Good night. Thank you very much.
Delaware Debates is a joint initiative of the University of Delaware's Center for Political Communication and WDDE 91.1 FM, Delaware First Media, with support from AARP Delaware and the American Cancer Society Cancer Action Network.